Good afternoon. And first of all, congratulations. You've all passed the first test today, which was coming to the investment section and not the trading section. So well done. And I know for a lot of you, it would have been a very, very difficult decision because most of what we hear and read and learn about investing leads us to believe that we need to be making more decisions, that we need to be buying and selling, that we need to be watching markets every day, that we need to be more active. And it makes sense because in most parts of our life, the more active we are and the more involved we are, the more success we have, whether it's time spent with our families, whether it's practicing for a sport, or whether it's studying for an exam. Usually the more effort you put into something, the better the outcomes you get. Today, I'm here to tell you that investing is one of the few areas in your life that the opposite is true. In fact, the more effort you put into investing, the worse you'll probably do, and the less effort you put into investing, the better you'll probably do. And I know this because I used to sit on the other side of the fence. I used to be a professional trader. In fact, I started trading at the age of 10. I bought my first share at the age of 10. By the time I was 13, I had won the ASX school share market game against 40,000 other students, which I won two more times at school and then twice again at university before I started trading for a hedge fund and then at the age of 20 started trading for a bank, UBS, so trading the bank's capital. So I've seen the trading side. But 5 years ago, I decided that it was really important that I left that world in order to move across and try and educate more people about why they shouldn't be trading. In fact, my belief is that 99.9% of people invested in the share market or involved in the share market should absolutely not be trading, despite what everyone else out there is probably telling you. And so today, I'm going to be sharing the way that we look at investing at StockSpot, which is a business I run now. We aim to build sensible long-term portfolios for people, and we aim to focus on the few areas in investing that you can control. So when it comes to investing, there's things that you have absolutely no control over. The great thing is you don't need to worry about them. But there's a few things you can control, and that is the risk you take, the costs you pay, and your own behavior. And today I'm going to be focusing on how you can focus on those things in order to be a successful investor. Now, investing to me is a bit like cooking a great meal. And admittedly, I'm not the best at that, but stay with me. You need to, first of all, pick the right ingredients. Secondly, you need to make sure that those ingredients are combined in the right way. And finally, you need to put that in the oven and make sure it cooks at the right temperature. So I'm going to go through each of these steps and hopefully you can take away something that you can apply for your own investing. So step number one, selecting the right ingredients. Now, this is a step that I see people make a couple of key mistakes in. So a lot of Australians I see making a mistake, which is not having enough ingredients in their portfolio. A lot of Aussies only invest in Australian shares, and this is a great example of not having enough ingredients. On the flip side, there's people who think that if they just put in more and more ingredients, it's going to help them. And these people put in too many ingredients. They think that if they make it more complex and they put more in there, they're going to get better results. And that's also not true. And then the final mistake that I see quite often is that people think that if they pay more for those ingredients, they're going to get a better result. And that is another furphy that's not true. And hopefully by the end of the day, you'll believe me on that one. Now, we're very lucky in Australia. Compared to so many other parts of the world, we have a wonderful array of choice of ingredients to put into our portfolios. That's why we're here at an ASX event today. The ASX is a wonderful array of choice that it provides people on investments to pick. You can choose from direct shares, and this is where I started investing, and probably a lot of you have as well, where you're buying individual businesses that are listed on the ASX. There's about 2,000 or over 2,000 of those choices. Then there's a choice of managed funds or listed investment companies. So this is where you pay a professional team of people to try and pick the best stocks or time the market in order to get you a great result. And then the final group, which is one that I'm quite passionate about, are exchange traded funds. So rather than paying a professional team to try and time the market and pick shares, ETFs invest in the entire market. So they basically track an entire asset class and they give you the return of that entire asset class. They buy all of the securities inside of that asset class and they typically do it at a very, very low cost. So there's a lot of choices out there, and it can be quite confusing. Like anything in life, having a lot of choice is often, is often a problem because it makes it hard to work out what to have. But I'm going to give you a bit of a framework to help you think about what needs to be considered when you choose those ingredients for your portfolios, and it's a framework that we use at StockSpot. Now, the first thing you need to know about the share market, and in fact most investment markets, is that the mathematics of investing is probably quite different to what you imagine they are. And you've probably all heard of the saying before that you need to put your eggs in many different baskets, that diversification is important. But you may not have stopped to consider, what that actually means and why that's the case. But I want to explain that to you right now. Now, this is a wonderful study that was done in the US recently that looked at every share that has ever been listed on the US share market ever. There were tens of thousands of them. And then it had a look at the returns of those shares over the long run. And let me explain what it found. So if you have a look at the black line there, that is the average market return over time. And what you can see is that actually two-thirds of shares listed on the stock market did worse than the average share, did worse than the index. Two-thirds of shares. So if you have a portfolio of 20 stocks, the chances are 14 of them are going to do worse than the index itself. But there's a much scarier statistic than that, and that is that 42% of shares actually give negative returns over their entire lifetimes listed on the share market. So not just worse than the market, negative returns. So probably 8 out of 20 of your shares are going to give you negative returns. Now, you might be thinking, well, how is this even possible? Such poor performance. And the reason is this tiny little blip on the right-hand side of the chart here, which is the small amount of shares that generate enormous returns. And what they found in this US study was that just 4% of companies generated all of the wealth in the US share market of all time. Now, you might be thinking, okay, well, that's fine. I'm sure I can find those 4% of stocks and be successful. I've heard of Apple and Google and Amazon, or in Australia, Afterpay and Xero and all these great performing companies. But it's not as easy as that. Those great performing companies are always changing. So in the US, in the 90s, it wasn't Apple and Google and Facebook. It was Walmart and Pfizer and other businesses like this, and Dell. It's always changing, and it's actually quite difficult to pick them. Now, you probably often hear, fund managers, saying that that's, their jobs to pick them. They're going to help you find the undervalued companies. And they only invest in, these great undervalued businesses. In fact, I don't think I've ever heard a fund manager say that they try and pick overvalued businesses. So there's thousands of them out there trying to pick undervalued businesses. The problem is that the price of securities reflects the collective wisdom of everyone out there in the market trying to decide what they're worth. So the chance that a single fund manager or you as an individual investor has knowledge that's useful and different to the knowledge everyone else has is almost zero. And this is seen pretty clearly in the results of professional fund managers. So if you have a look in Australia over the last 15 years at the performance of fund managers versus the market, the stats are pretty alarming. So 80% of Australian fund managers have underperformed the index over the last 15 years. And the stats are pretty similar over 10 and 5 years and shorter periods as well. Actually, that's pretty good. In the US, it's 90% of fund managers that have underperformed the index. And in other asset classes, it's higher still. So in fixed income or bonds, 98% of Australian active managers have done worse than the fixed income index over the last 15 years. So even these professionals that have degrees and it's all they're doing all the time struggle to find these 4% of companies. And you might be thinking, well, that's all right. I will just give my money to those fund managers that have done very well. The problem is those best performing fund managers are always changing as well. So I had a look back at the top 25% of Aussie fund managers in 2014. And do you want to know how many of them are still in the top quartile this year? 1.3% of them. So there's very few fund managers that are actually able to consistently perform. And the statistics are also interesting in how much data you need to work out whether a fund manager's results are due to skill or luck. You actually need 22 years of performance data to be confident that a fund manager's performance, even if they are doing well, is not just because they're lucky. So it's very, very difficult to pick these great stocks. And that is one of the beauties of index funds. Index funds invest in all of the companies. And in fact, they're the only way you can guarantee that you always own that tinier number of companies that are driving all of the share market returns. The second thing you need to know is that costs are a killer. When it comes to investing, the more you pay, the less you get. And I know it's very different to many other parts in your life, but it's a pretty clear phenomenon. Costs to me are like the heart disease of investing. You don't really notice them over the short term, and you can have a bad diet year to year, but over many, many years, they will definitely kill you. And I think the best way to illustrate this is to show the compounding effect of costs. So if you invest $1,000 as a young'un and invest it for 65 years, so a lifetime, in a portfolio that returns 8% a year, you'll end up with about $148,000. Now, just pay 2.5% a year in costs, and that could be in brokerage fees, it could be in newsletter subscriptions, in stock tipping software. There's all sorts of ways that you can pay for costs when it comes to being an investor. But by paying 2.5% in your costs, your end amount ends up at $32,000 only. So you actually four times your money over your lifetime by avoiding 2.5% a year in costs. Now, these two facts alone should frame your way of thinking of what ingredients need to go into your portfolio. The absolute need for you to diversify to guarantee that you own the best performing shares, and your need to keep your costs low. And these two facts are why we exclusively recommend to our clients to only invest in low-cost ETFs or index funds, because they give you both of those: extremely low costs and broad diversification. And you don't have to trust me, I'm not the only one talking about this. In fact, someone that you all would have heard of has been harking on about this since his first mention in his investor newsletter in 1993, Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett is one of the biggest fans in the world of index investing. In fact, for anyone prepared to listen, every year in his annual investor letter, he tells people, do not pick stocks. Do not give your money to active fund managers. Simply buy the index. In fact, recently, or in 2007, he had a bet with a fund manager that said, Warren, that's garbage. I bet I can pick 10 fund managers who will beat the index fund over 10 years. And that competition just ended last year, and Buffett absolutely trounced him. His index fund, following the US share market, beat those carefully selected, brilliant, smart fund managers by 80%. Not only has he put his money down there and won a $1 million bet, which went to charity, but he's also said that for his estate, when he passes on, he wants it to be invested in 90% a US share index fund and 10% a bond index fund. So he truly believes this, not only for average investors, but even for really smart investors, the best way to grow your long-term wealth is to index. Now, we're all not as fortunate as Warren with our investing that we have an unlimited time frame. So with his estate, he wants that to be going on for hundreds and hundreds of years. And because of that, he can afford to be putting 90% in shares. The problem with that is a 90-10 allocation between shares and bonds opens you up for big short-term volatility, which is important when your time horizon is shorter, like probably most of ours. So for instance, in the financial crisis, if you had 90% in shares and only 10% in bonds, you would have lost about 39% of your capital. And that's pretty stomach churning and pretty difficult for most people to stick to that strategy and continue. So I'm going to share a couple of extra ingredients that I believe Aussies can add to their portfolio to help improve the quality of their returns. And by that I mean ensure that you're actually losing less when markets fall and not give away too much return on the upside when markets are doing well. Ingredient number one won't surprise any of you. It's Australian shares. You probably already all own them. We advise clients to invest in the ASX 300 index ETF, which gives you exposure to 300 different companies. And over the very long term, about 100 years, that has returned about 11% per annum, which is a wonderful return. The problem is some years you have terrible returns. So I'm sure a lot of you owned shares in 2008 and saw that the drawdown from the peak to the trough in Australian shares was 55%. A lot of people, aren't able to continue investing, with that sort of drawdown, which is why you need ingredient number two, which is high-grade corporate and government bonds or fixed interest. This is one I think a lot of Aussies aren't aware of and don't have in their portfolios, but it's really valuable for one main reason, which is that when Australian shares fall, you've got a very, very good chance that bonds are going to provide a bit of a cushion in your portfolio. So this is a chart showing the last six times that our share market has had a negative performance in a calendar year. And in each of those years, bonds have shone. They've done really, really well, and they've helped to provide a bit of return when the share part of your portfolio hasn't been doing well. In fact, they're the best proven asset over the long run of moving in the opposite of direction to shares when shares fall. And that's why we think if you're only going to have two assets in your portfolio, it should be Australian shares and high-grade Australian bonds. Now, and I'm not talking about individual company bonds, because that's quite risky, or you know, lending your money to a property developer in Queensland. I'm talking about high-grade corporate and government bonds. And again, there's an ETF that allows you to invest in those. The next ingredient, you know, for anyone that's seen how badly our markets performed over the last 10 years, won't surprise you, is global shares. Now, Australian shares have had a wonderful 100 years of performance, but for some periods, our market doesn't do as well. And for all sorts of different reasons. It could be because our economy's not doing well, or it could simply be because the sectors in our market that are bigger, which are typically resources in financials, aren't on fire. And that's what we've seen over the last 10 years. Resources and financials have done nowhere near as well as other sectors in other markets, like technology. And technology is a sector we hardly have any of in the Australian market, but is a huge sector in markets like the US and Germany and Japan. So the reason you want exposure to other markets is because different countries are cyclical at different times, and no one really knows when the right time is, so you want to have exposure to many countries. And we split global actually into two different groups. We have developed market global shares, so these are shares in countries like the US and Japan and Europe, so you know, aging populations, you know, slower growth typically, but more developed businesses, and then emerging market shares. So these are countries like China and India that have fast-growing populations and typically faster-growing share markets, but they're also more volatile. And we split our clients' money across those two different types of global investments. And if you split your money across both of those, you get access to hundreds or thousands of different shares from around the world, again, using ETFs. Now, the last ingredient, and admittedly, it's definitely the most controversial in our portfolios, and it gets the most questions, up until recently, where it's had 20% return over the last year and suddenly all of the questions have stopped, is gold. Now, you may think that you know, the only sorts of people that own gold are those that are, you know, preparing for the apocalypse, that, you know, have their bunkers underground with their, you know, tinned baked beans and their guns, and that they're waiting for the government to go rogue. This isn't why we own gold, although it is an option if you feel that way to own gold. The reason you own gold is because, like bonds, gold is a great diversifier. It's one of the few assets that has historically performed very well when share markets haven't, and been able to, in between those periods, preserve your wealth. A great example of that was in 2008. Our share market, as I mentioned before, fell 50%. Gold rose by 50%. And I'm not talking about gold shares, because gold shares can be more volatile and don't tend to have this sort of performance. I'm talking about gold bullion. And we invest in a gold bullion ETF that actually stores this bullion in a vault in London. So you can actually now, via an ETF, own gold bullion. And we advise all of our clients to have an allocation to this. Think of gold as the insurance on your insurance. If bonds in your portfolio are the insurance policy, gold is the insurance when that insurance doesn't pay out. And occasionally, for all sorts of different reasons, like inflation is one of them, bonds and shares don't always move in the opposite direction. And when they don't, gold's an asset that's going to help your portfolio not lose as much. It's the asset you don't want to go well, because if it's going well, it usually means the other things aren't going so well. Now, those four ingredients are in my view, all you really need to create a wonderful diversified portfolio. And there's plenty of other things you can add in there if you want. You know, there's the infrastructure and property, and there's venture capital and private equity. There is no limit to the number of asset choices out there. But based on the research, none of these other assets really add a lot of value to your portfolio beyond these four key ingredients. So adding more complexity above this isn't really going to pay off with a better quality of returns. So the next stage I'm going to talk about is combining those ingredients in your portfolio. Now, combining ingredients is as important as picking the right ingredients. And we follow a few steps in order to work out for different clients how to combine them. And you can apply some of these lessons to your own portfolio. So the first step we try and do is understand the amount of risk our clients are willing to and able to take, their risk capacity. Now, as I mentioned before, there's only a few things you can control with investing. It's risk, cost, and your own behavior. Risk is really important. It's really important that when you invest, the different assets you're investing in reflects how much risk you should be taking. And there's a few factors that drive this. So one of them, one of the more clear factors is your investment time horizon. The longer you're prepared to invest, the more risk you're able to take because you can withstand bigger ups and downs along the way. But there's other factors like how much liquidity do you need? You know, are you requiring this investment to generate income? You know, also, what experience do you have? People that tend to have more investment experience are also more willing to withstand ups and downs in the market. And so when clients start with us, we try and ascertain this in order to work out how much risk they should be taking. Now, once you work out how much risk you should be taking, the next step is actually to make sure that you're invested in a combination of those assets that I mentioned before that reflects how much risk you should be taking. And this is something that may seem a little bit confusing, and actually it is quite complex. But some wonderful research was done on this about 50 years ago that won a Nobel Prize in 1990 that showed the best way to combine different assets in order to give you the best possible return for the lowest amount of risk. It was called modern portfolio theory. And it's still the highest regarded academic work to decide the right allocation to different assets in your portfolio, and it's what we use. And so we then allocate clients to a mix of those four assets I discussed before that best reflects their capacity to take risk. And the beauty of using asset allocation in this way is that you can drastically reduce how much risk you're taking versus, and I put up here the example of just owning Australian shares. So if you just own Aussie shares, you're going to experience volatility or ups and downs of about 16% a year, but you can massively slash how much volatility you have in your portfolio and only concede a little bit of return by diversifying into these other assets. And that is really the only free ride in investing. Is through diversification, you can take a lot less risk and not give up too much return. So that's the second step. And I wanted to give a couple of examples of how this actually plays out. So as an online service, and our minimum investment is $2,000, we tend to have a lot of younger clients who are starting off their investment journey because they want to work out how to start investing. What we find with the younger clients is they typically have a longer term time horizon. You know, they've got decades ahead of them and they want to get started. They want more growth. They want to benefit from that compounding effect. So typically we'll recommend a portfolio that's more geared towards the higher growth assets. And by those, I mean Australian shares and global shares. And I'm not even talking, 90-10, like Buffett said. We think a sensible allocation is even something like 70% in growth assets versus 30% in defensive assets, because that extra cushion you get is going to keep you invested when times get tough, and nobody knows when they are. But one of the conversations we often have to have with younger clients is actually making sure that they are committed to investing for at least a few years. Because we know with millennials these days, they want results now. They want to see returns straight away, and unfortunately, investing isn't like that. You don't get guaranteed returns every month, and you have to stick with it in order to enjoy the long-term uptrend. So something we have to really educate young people on is their need to just stick with it and keep investing. But the great thing is young people are generally able to top up regularly or dollar cost average, which helps them ride out the ups and downs in markets. The next group is pre-retired people. So these are people that are typically later in their career. They've already built up some wealth, but they've also experienced some ups and downs in markets. So they have a bit more experience and understand, first of all, that markets are volatile, but secondly, that there is a benefit of having some defensive assets to cushion their portfolios. Now, typically with pre-retirees, we'll recommend a strategy that's more like 50-50, 50 growth, 50 defensive, because that will really remove a lot of the big downside potential in a portfolio. That's typically what we'll recommend to people at that life stage. The final group are retired people, and self-managed super funds are actually one of the biggest buyers of ETFs in Australia at the moment. So ETFs have grown from 10 billion to 50 billion in Australia over the last 5 years, and ETFs have accounted for half of that. So we see a lot of interest from self-managed super funds, but getting the risk tolerance right is important for SMSFs as well. A lot of self-managed retirees are looking for income, so that's a question that they have and something that's important. They also really want to stop big drawdowns in their portfolio. They wouldn't be comfortable with a fall of 20 or 30%, and that's how asset allocation can help to reduce the risk of big downsides. I should point out, though, with retirees, just because you're at retirement doesn't mean you should always be investing in a more conservative portfolio. You know, when you reach your mid-60s, you've hopefully got 20 or 30 years ahead, and that's plenty of time to enjoy, you know, a few market cycles. And so really there's the ability to invest in a more balanced or growth portfolio instead, but you need to be more willing to ride the ups and downs in the markets along the way. And this is more of a personal question for you as opposed to something I or anyone else can decide for you. So final step is keeping your portfolio just right. And this is the one where it really comes back to you to make the best decisions. So there's really only one change you need to make once you've got a diversified portfolio of different assets, and that is you need to monitor that portfolio over time and check when the weights of the assets in your portfolio move away from the starting weights, because usually this indicates that your portfolio has become more risky. Generally, what happens over time is the growth assets in a portfolio, like shares, tend to do better than the defensive assets, and that means the growth part of your portfolio tends to get bigger and bigger over time. And if there is a market correction, that means you're now taking more risk than you should be. So what you should be doing is periodically rebalancing out of those assets that have become too big in your portfolio back into those assets that have shrunk in your portfolio. And this is known as rebalancing. Now, we automate this process for clients, so we're checking this every day. But if you're doing it for yourself, there's a few things you need to focus on. And one is that you don't need to be doing this every day. This is something that typically you should be doing when assets move, you know, we think 15 to 30% away from their starting weights, which generally will happen every 6 months to 2 years. But it's really important you do it, and it's quite emotionally a difficult thing to do, to sell those things that have done well, because usually those are the things that you want to be buying more of, that everyone's talking about, that are in the newspaper, but you actually need to be harvesting the profits out of those and putting them into the things that haven't done well. And so emotionally this is hard to manage, and that's why we think automating it, or at least coming up with a process that you're prepared to stick to, is important to get it right. Now, apart from rebalancing, there's very little you need to do apart from control your own instincts. We have an instinct to do stuff when it comes to investing, and it's a very dangerous instinct. And you're going to hear, you know, your friends tell you to do something, your stockbroker, you're going to see someone on the news, you're going to read something in the newspaper. There are so many temptations to act. The hardest thing to do, and the thing that will differentiate you from all of the other investors out there, is your ability to do nothing. It's difficult, but when you hear some information that makes you want to act, the best way I think you can approach it is step back and realize that that bit of information you've heard, first of all, is probably already reflected in the market, and secondly, it's probably only one drop in the ocean compared to all the information out there that's driving prices. So really, what you know is only a really small percentage of all of the different things influencing markets. And there's a few great studies that have shown the importance of doing nothing. I wanted to share a couple of them with you today. So first of all, you'll see this chart on the right. So this is a study that the Dalbar Group in the US has been doing for the last 30 years. And it basically compares the returns of the index, the US share market index, to the average investor investing in managed funds in the US. And what it finds consistently over the last 30 years is that because people pay too much, and that also are switching at the wrong times, switching fund managers, switching strategies, pulling money in and out, the average investor earns 7% per year less than the index in the US. And I imagine in Australia the results are quite similar, even though a similar study hasn't been done. I think the more, for me, what I think is the more interesting study was one that was done by Fidelity. So Fidelity is like the ComSec in the US. They're one of the biggest online stockbrokers. And they did a study across their tens of thousands of customers to work out what are the customers that do the best. You know, what are the online stock traders that have the best performance? What are the characteristics we can share with the rest of our customers? And what they found was that there was one group that did much better than all of the others. And that was the guys that forgot their login details. Much better than all of those people that logged in every day in trading were the people that simply forgot they had an account at all. And I think there is no better way to explain the importance of doing nothing than to show that that's the case. And to be honest, I was a bit surprised that Fidelity published this, given that they're a stockbroker and they want people to be logging in every day. But that is the issue with the industry, is that most of the people out there, you know, in all parts of the financial services industry, they're motivated to encourage you to act. And that's great for them, but terrible for you. So if I leave you just with one final thought today, it's that investing is one of the few times in your life that by doing less, you're going to get better results. I know it's hard to comprehend, but do less, do better. So as long as you've got a diversified portfolio spread across different assets, you keep your costs low, you rebalance occasionally, as long as you do those three things, you can lose your passwords and then go outside and enjoy your lives.